thank you for coming this evening. Call to order this regular scheduled board meeting of June 21st, 2016 of the Vicksburg Warren School District. First item, we would like to take a moment of silence to a district employee that we have lost during this past week that meant a lot to a lot of our children, to a lot of us. And we'd like to, if you would indulge board members, to take a moment of silence for Sarinda Davis. Thank you. Our hearts and thoughts and prayers go out to the Davis family at this time. Our next item will be our invocation, and I believe Mr. Naylor is going to lead us in our invocation. Sir.
Yes. Let's bow. Father God, we come to you on this day, Father God. Thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done for us, Father God. Most important, Father God, for sending your son Jesus down to die for our sins, Father. Lord God, we know we are imperfect beings, Father God. We come to you, Father God. We have a right to your kingdom, Father. We pray, Lord, that you bless this meeting. You bless the overseers of this meeting, Father God, and those, Lord, that are looking on, Father God, that you allow us to conduct business, Father God, to represent you well, Father. We want to represent our students and our community to the best of our abilities. We thank you, Father, you've done all you will do. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Mr. Naylor. Next, we have item for the agenda is adoption of the agenda. Are there any additions or deletions to the agenda or suggested changes?
We need to change, Mr. President, if I'm in order. I-1?
Correct.
I-1. I would like to, if it's the pleasure of the board, to move I-1 from I-1 to right under the minutes after the reading of the minutes of the regular meeting on C, make it
so
C2.
To move the approval of the hunting and fishing bids to
C, be make it C2.
Okay. Any other additions or deletions to the agenda? Seeing as none, do we have a motion? That is your motion, Mr. Sturgis?
Yes, sir.
Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and proper second to approve the amended agenda. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign. We have an approved agenda. Next item on the agenda would be the approval of the minutes. Seeing as our secretary is not here, do we have any additions or deletions or corrections to the minutes for our regular scheduled meeting on May 19th and our special call meeting on the 26th? Seeing as none, do we have a motion to accept the minutes and suspend with reading of the minutes? Is there a motion?
I'd like to make a motion that we accept the minutes of the past meetings, our call meeting and our regular meeting, if there's no adding or deletion.
Second, Sturgis.
We have a motion and second to accept the presented minutes for the May 19th and May 26th meeting. We have a motion and a proper second. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign. Minutes have been approved. Next item on the agenda is our opening of the bids for the, I'm not even going to try to say it, Bogadesha and Kings Point sections. So, Mr. Attorney, you want to handle that?
Thank you, Mr. President. Here's, we have two bids for the Kings Point track. We've got four bids for Bogadesha track. So I'll start with Kings Point bids. First bid is in the amount of $6,440. It is on behalf of MJK Property, a Mississippi partnership. certified check in amount of $644, meeting the 10% requisite. This bid appears to be in order. Minimum bid, by the way, board members, was $6,439.20. So it does meet the minimum. Second bid from Raymond B. May is in the amount $6,439.20. It's a certified check in that amount for 10% of the amount of the bid, and this bid also appears to be in order.
How much is that, Mr.?
$6,439.20. It meets the minimum bid.
Okay.
The first one was
$6,440. So the first bid is actually the higher bid of the two. I believe Mr. May is the current leaseholder. So if I am correct about that, then the higher bid is the first bid that is for MJK property, and that would be the bid that would be to be approved by the board, subject to the right of the current leaseholder, who I think made the second bid, to match the highest bid.
Okay.
Do you understand?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So basically, we have a highest bid. We'll accept that bid pursuant the current leaseholder not match that bid.
That's correct.
They have so how long do they have to match that?
We give them 10 days.
10 days.
Yes. Okay. The motion would be to approve the bid of MJK property, subject to the right of the current leaseholder to match the highest bid.
Do we have a motion?
Yes, I'd like to make a motion that we accept the higher bid with the knowledge of knowing that if the current bidders do not match, then we will take the higher bid as of tonight. Is that correct, Mr. Attorney? And within 10 days. They have a 10 days.
Correct.
Grace.
Second.
We have a motion, a proper second, to accept the MJK Properties highest bid pursuant that the current leaseholder does not match that bid within 10 days. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Thank you, Mr. President. Now we have four bids for section 1413 North Range 2 East, which is the Bogadisha track. First bid is in the amount of $8,298.10. It is submitted by Clifton H. Harper, H-A-R-P-E-R. The minimum bid, by the way, is $4,150, so it does meet that. And make sure they got the requisite funds here. They do have a 10% deposit in cash of $829.81. This bid also appears to be in order. Second bid is submitted by Dustin Henson, H-E-N-S-O-N. It's in the amount of $12,500. Does have the 10% deposit cash of $1,250. That bid also appears to be in order. Third bid is submitted by John R. Myers and Capital Hunting, I think that's Capital Hunting Club, John R. Myers. It's in the amount of $4,150, which is the minimum bid, and there is certified funds in the amount of $415 submitted. That bid appears to be in order. bid. Submitted by Stephen Milhauser, M-I-H-L-H-A-U-S-E-R. That bid is for $17,000. There is a certified check in the amount of $1,700, which is the 10% required deposit. And that bid also appears to be in order. So it appears that the highest bid is submitted by Stephen Milhauser. And I believe Mr. Myers is the current share, current leaseholder. So the motion would be to approve the bid of Mr. Milhauser, subject to the right of the current lessee to match the bid, the highest bid.
So the current, the minimum bid amount is set by the secretary. How is that set?
The minimum bid's the last bid, the amount of money that was on the prior bid.
Prior,
that's what
prior
it's, that's what it's leasing for. It
currently?
Is leasing for currently, correct.
We have a motion.
I'd like to make a motion that we accept Mr. or Mrs., I don't know, Milhauser bid of $17,000 with the knowledge of knowing that the person that owns it now can match it or will match it within 10 days.
Is there a second?
Second.
There's a motion and a proper second to accept the highest bid with the stipulation that the current leaseholder has the option to match within 10 days. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign.
Mr. President, I'm going to give Ms. Jeffrey back the, we've got two bids that have cash in them, and I'll give her back those bids so that we can submit these back to the persons who did not get the,
okay,
bids were not approved.
And we can,
along with the others that had certified checks.
And I believe they're here if you'd like to meet with them or however you want. All right, next item on our agenda is our superintendent's report.
All right, got a couple great things that are on our agenda I would like to make note. And the first thing I would like to do is invite Mr. Russett to come to the podium to honor our child, who is Zachary Moore, who made a perfect score on his Project Lead the Way end of the year test in biomedical science. Now, to put this in perspective, this is more rare than making a 36 on the ACT. So you're talking about exciting. That was exciting for a first-year student. They called us and said, oh my goodness, how awesome a program you must have. And I say we have an awesome student. So.
We did. And we didn't really know what we were getting into with this program, but Zachary took the class, and is his teacher here? It's Ms. Lamb. Come on up, Ms. Lamb. And Ms. Lamb didn't really know what she was getting into when she accepted the position to teach this class, but it has been phenomenal. And all the conferences she went to this year, everybody told her, well, you won't get an advanced score your first year. Don't get upset. This is all new. This is all new. And then she, I could hear her screaming from the other side of the building when she got that score, when she saw the scores. So congratulations, everyone. Would like to invite, is Anitra here or is Ms. Jenkins? I know I saw you, but I didn't know, I didn't see Anitra. If you'd come on up and talk to us and give us a little bit update on our backpack program.
Okay, perfect. I got a little handout here. I'd like to give you guys on.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, well, I'd like to take the opportunity to introduce myself again, Angela Jenkins. This is my mother, Beverly. She works in the school system, and she's going to be my testimony for VIS. I wouldn't dare call the other counselors in throughout the summer, so I said, well, I got my mom will come for me anyway. So, I wanted to take the opportunity to thank you guys for allowing the school district to participate in our backpack program this year. And I wanted to give you the numbers for the school year. We had 5 schools participate: the Alternative School, Dana Road, Sherman Avenue, VIS, and WCI. So we had 4 students at the Alternative School participate, and they had 5 siblings, which we fed 9. Dana Road had 12 students, they had 13 siblings, which was 25 fed. Sherman Avenue had 9 students, 16 siblings, and 25 fed. VIS had 12 students, 13 siblings, 25 fed, and WCI had 13 students, 25 siblings, which equaled 38 fed. We also gave each counselor 2 empty bags a week, and we filled them with food in case another student came in throughout the week that needed some food as well. So that equaled 10 additional students for the 5 counselors. So throughout the year, each week we gave up to 132 children food for the backpack program this year. The donations we received were backpacks, food, checks, gift cards, and volunteers. The backpack expenses did not exceed $5 per weekend. And I know last year the district helped get a lot of the backpacks and stuff like that. And if you guys felt the kindness of your heart to do it again this year, we would appreciate it. The second page was just a sample of the non-perishable food items that we accepted, and we disseminated out throughout the community. And the last page is actually a list of the sponsors that we did get throughout the year. And I want to just announce those right quick: Kroger, Byram, Elevate Church, the Vicksburg Association for Women, Riverwalk Casino, Diamond Jacks Casino, Entergy, Central Access, United Healthcare, Cruz and Associates, United Way — that's actually where we pack the backpacks every week — Barnes Glass, Service Masters, LeSueur Chemonts, Mr. and Mrs. John Ferguson, AKAs, Mr. and Mrs. Brother Blackburn, Worship Christian Center, Gaskin Family Chiropractor, Venture Technologies, Church of the Holy Trinity, Trinity Temple Baptist Church, Crossway Church, House of Jacob, Unitech, Philip Jones Electric, Prescott's AC and Heating, Hennessy Thames, and Levitt, Bingham Memorial, Mount Calvary Church, Mr. and Mrs. Eddie Cresap, that's Michelle's, Connolly's mother and dad at United Way, Essence Civic and Social Club, Versatile Civic and Social Club, and Porter's Chapel UMC Church. So I'd like to take the opportunity to let my mom tell you guys the impact that it made at her school, which was VIS.
Every Thursday evening at 6 o'clock, we'd go and pack the backpacks. And on Friday mornings, well, on Thursday afternoons, the children would all have their backpacks back to school. So when Friday morning come, they were looking forward to getting their backpacks before they'd leave school on Friday afternoon. And on Monday, or maybe Tuesday, they'd bring their backpacks back so they could get some more by Friday. They were excited. And they'd always say, "Miss Jenkins, I enjoyed such and such. It was so good. And my sister took mine, and I told her she can't have mine. So I need you to put another one of those in my backpack this weekend." And so we had a great time. And it's all because we love the children, rain, shine, sleet, or snow. On Thursday evenings, we were always there fixing the backpacks for Friday morning, because had we missed the Friday and those children didn't have those backpacks, they were going to be wondering what happened. They were going to be sad. So they were always anxious to get whatever was in there, and so we made them happy. So it was a good thing. And so for those of you who don't know, on this third page, it's my daughter who died, Monica. And so that's why we did this program, so, because she fed everybody in the world. So Angie fussed at me because I wanted it to be named Reagan's Backpack Weekend. And she said, "Mommy, it doesn't matter who named it or what they named it, just long as we feed the kids. So I just wanted those of you who didn't know that we're doing this because of Monica.
Well, we are very thankful, and I know there's a lot of students that received good lunches over the weekends that might not have without us, so that was a great venture. I'd like to invite Brad Mason to the podium. We're in knee-deep in the middle of our Johnson Controls energy efficiency upgrade in IT, and we got him here, and he can kind of give us a brief update, and he brought a handout for the board.
For those in the y'all's packets.
Okay.
Yeah. I think so. But it's a two-page. Here, I've got an extra here, Mr. Thank
you.
Yeah, it's a very exciting time here. Energy project is going really well. The IT project is ahead of schedule, so we just felt like it'd be a good opportunity to get in front of the board and tell you how everything is going. So let me introduce J.D. Hudson. He's our project manager. Let him come up here and talk about and see about. He is the our eyes and ears on the ground here. So, and I know the board answer any questions or anything that you guys have.
No, we go by through the contract. We go by facility improvement measures, which is films, is listed on the emails, and the first one is lighting. Through most, the majority of the schools, we're down to the two junior highs. We still got a little exterior here and there, and the parking lot lights at Dana and Sherman that we hadn't touched, but I know y'all go touch that after a while. So intent with film one, with the lighting, is to be substantially complete July the 15th. That means, you know, we've got 99.9% of it done, but we're going back through everything. There was probably an office somewhere that was locked. There's, you know, a closet that we couldn't get in. So we go back through all of that, make sure we got everything. And the next film on the list is 2.1, which is the energy management controls, the thermostats, the stuff that saves most of the money. All the elementary schools are done. We can actually see them over at Bill's office on the head end. And can adjust and play, and we're working on Warren Central High School right now is about 50%. Sherman and Dana have the communications cable in, so we'll be getting them online, in the next month or so. Beachwood's the same way. Vicksburg High School is probably 75-80% complete at this time, so it's coming along pretty. There's always challenges with the controls. We plan on being substantially complete with that one August the 5th, and then we probably got a 4 to 6 week process that we'll go through just fine tuning and that kind of thing. Look, on 3.1 is the rooftop unit replacements, which are the big units that went on the rooftop. Warren Central High School got 38. I changed 37 in 7 days. The 38th one took me 4 days. So Murphy's always around. Things happen, it takes a little while. Beachwood, we'll do next week. We're doing the junior high, Vicksburg Junior High right now. It got 13, 14 units. We'll get through over there tomorrow. And there's 4 at Warren Central Junior High to do, but we're gonna go do Beachwood first, and then we'll block back over there. Wall unit replacements, which are hard units, the big units that just slide through the wall in the classroom, we replaced those 2 or 3 months ago. So they're all running and doing what. Chiller over at Vicksburg High School has been running since probably mid-March, first of April. So water upgrades, we're 100% complete. We still go back and fine tune and look and make sure we didn't miss something. Office that we couldn't get into. Waste management is the same thing. All the slabs are poured. All my compactors, the 5 compactors are sitting in Clinton, ready to come over. I gotta have power, and Sonny's working on that. So. The IT project.
Bringing weight, sir.
Let me answer your question real quick. On the chiller replacement at Vicksburg, it's up and running now?
Yes, sir. It's been running.
Okay.
Yeah. We started that thing by like mid-March or so, April.
So what does it mean will be available?
It is available. It's been online. It's been the number one machine. Okay. There's three machines over there. This machine's been taking the load.
Okay.
I'll have to shut it down because when we complete the controls over there, we're going to change those old valves, old control valves that are on it, and put the new ones on it. So, you know, it's running.
Thank you.
IT probably has processed a lot faster than I thought it would. Non-E-rate, this building, the building over there, the bus barn, the offices on the hills, that's been done and on 6 weeks or so now. Yeah. The notice to proceed that we received for the E-rate, the four, which is the two high schools and the two junior highs. Vicksburg High School was the first one that went online. Warren Central High School is online. The two junior highs we're in now. Vicksburg Junior High will probably go online Friday, and then Warren Central probably next Friday. And I think I had a note in there about I needed a notice to proceed for the other buildings, which is starting to grow straight and go through that manner, but superintendent signed it, so I got it. So,
may I regress for just a minute and ask, in the gym, and I probably don't know what I'm talking about, but in the gym where the air conditioning is, air conditioning above the gym floor, did you all work on those?
At where?
Vicksburg High.
We have not yet.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
We have not.
But that's part of the scope.
Yeah. That those air handling units in the gymnasium at Vicksburg High, yes, rework new valves, new controls, and all that stuff. Yes.
But we don't. They're not replacing.
No, they're not. Okay. Replaced.
No. Any further questions? Any other board members?
All right.
Yeah, we submit this I think every month or so. It's just every once in a while we want to keep the board abreast of what's going on.
Thank y'all so
much. Thank you very much.
Thank y'all. We appreciate it.
There's several other items on the superintendent's agenda where I've been and what I've done. One of the things I would like to point out is we were invited to attend the Innovative Institute in Starkville, Mississippi that was hosted by Mississippi State University at the Mill. And it was great to be recognized as one of the three innovative districts in the state. We were informed after that they'd be setting up two site visits to bring people from all over the state to Vicksburg, Mississippi, and we're the only district we're doing that with. So that was pretty impressive to hear. Got a real nice banner, it's real pretty, and we're going to replicate that and get those out to the districts. And I believe that's it for me.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Shealy. Next item on the agenda would be our financial report. Ms. Burke, you're up.
Monthly financial report for month ending May 2016. However, we will have our bank reconciliations have been reconciled through June. So we are caught up as well as we are actually ahead of schedule with our bank reconciliations. If you take a look at the cash flow statement, we are now looking at full year being $1.4 million over our projected budget for the year and $4.8 million over the baseline of 7%. Now, I will say this, we're in a really good position. However, we still have a couple of weeks before the year closes, and then we go into our close period where we're still closing out the month. We'll be closing out 2016 in July and August. So we won't know how well we did for 2016 until we officially close the books. But based on where we are now, I think we are in a really good position. And just looking ahead at some of the things that I'm seeing in June, I think we'll probably end up better than we had anticipated. Moving on to our general fund statement of expenses and statement of receipts, you'll see that we are 94% in our district maintenance of all of our receipts collected, and full year total funds, we've collected 87% of all of our revenue projected for the year. And that still leaves, like I said, we still have the month of June to calculate in that number, as well as some receivables we'll probably end up putting on the books in July until we get those funds in. With our statement of expenses, we are 80% of our budget with our expenses, which is, like I said, puts us in a good position because we received 94% of our revenue, but we've only spent 80% of our expenses, but expenditures in the budget. And our budget and expenditures and receipts try to be as close as possible. So those two remaining neutral. If we keep that pace, we'll end up in the year a lot better than we had anticipated. Total district, we are 78% of our total district expenditures compared to the 87% of receipts full district. So again, we're in a much better position than we had planned, but that will determine more so as we close the books. Okay, moving on to casino revenue and casino. I'm sorry, it's been a long day. Casino revenue. We've received, and for casino revenue, we've actually received this month, $60,000 in our casino revenue. And we've received, for MAP, we received $2.29 million, as well as Avalorum. We are, we've actually received full year Avalorum request. We've actually received about $693,000. We are looking to come in a little less on our MAP simply because of the reduction that they imposed that will impact us for May and June. So we'll see that these 2 months. And I'm projecting it to be about $400,000 overall.
Okay. So we won't know until next month that we'll declare a shortfall?
I don't think we're going to declare a shortfall.
Okay.
Simply because, and the reason I say that is because in talking to MDE and looking at our assessments trying to get prepared for next year, the assessed valuations came in higher than we projected. And if you factor in the $3 million that was removed from our total assessed valuations, then with assessments being higher, we'll come in at or above what we've asked for. So we won't have a shortfall.
Okay.
So the $400,000, the way I understand it, it will not affect your cash flow, right?
No, sir. The $400,000 will not affect our cash flow simply because if you look down the expenditures, you'll see that we've actually been doing a lot better in not only personnel, but AP. So those things are kind of offset where we have the reduction in our state funds from MAP, as well as, you know, like I said, with assessed valuation coming in higher, we'll end up getting a little bit more in our funding for Avalorum. So that'll offset that $400,000 as well.
From this year, from the expect. Okay.
Yes, this year.
Because in reading the, our great legislators are thinking about reducing us again.
Yes, sir.
So would that affect us?
Yes, next year.
Okay.
It could potentially affect our funding, yes.
Okay.
But we have, I think the general idea is that we have items that are built into the budget that are items that we could forego,
yes.
Purchases,
yes, and
that
was
could help offset those.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
And those were the things that I took you guys through in the budget work
correct.
Session. You know, you can make the decision that we want to forego this based on funding. So, yes, we do have those things built into it. Okay. Those are the main things from a financial standpoint, unless you guys have any questions.
Looks like we might come in just a little bit high on, for the end of the year for casino revenue for the previous year.
Yes, sir, just a little.
But it's still down over, year over year.
Yes, sir.
The month of April, that's you showing zero, but I'm
yeah.
going to do what I shouldn't do is assume that we recouped in May.
Yes, we did. What okay. happened, there's been times where they may not, the person, I think that may have been the time when the person was out and they didn't get the check mailed to us in time, so we ended up having to deposit the next month's revenue.
Can they get a direct deposit set up for that?
I'm trying. I told them. And
I want my money.
I told them I want my interest just like
right.
they do. So.
May I ask one other question, ma'am, if I may?
Yes, sir.
I'm reading what you've given us here.
Yes, sir.
And I'm looking at the meals.
Yes, sir.
Is am I reading where it says 53?
Right now it's 53.58. That is currently, and that is based on the assessed valuation that we were provided previously. Now, if I use the assessed valuation that state supervisors provided MDE, then that may actually, our meals will go down simply because that's based on the old assessed valuation. But I have not adjusted that chart because I have not been able to meet with the supervisors and get that number confirmed myself. I want the actual assessed
valuation.
So has
that been scheduled or?
Yes, actually John said that he wouldn't have anything available that would actually be helpful to me until July anyway. So we're working to try to get those numbers, hopefully by the July board meeting.
So the, as of now, without the meeting, we are 53 meals.
Right now we are. But like I said, however, if I use the information that they provided, they are required to report to MDE, assessed valuation, so they can determine from, as they're calculating our MAP, what our local contributions are. So in looking at that, they had our supervisors or tax assessors to provide assessed valuation, and they provide us that number. So if I drop those assessed valuations into that formula you're looking at, our millage would actually be down.
You know how much?
About how much? Give or take. Now, this is quick saying.
I would think about probably about 0.3 mils. Yeah, about 0.34 mils.
Because what we found out, if y'all remember, they decreased the assessed valuation due to whatever reasons they said by about 1.8%, and then we actually that wasn't accurate. So
yeah, and then the other thing that happened over the course of the year, they added our
debt service
into our operations, which increased our millage as well.
So let me throw this. So they're asking the county for our assessed value to come up with basically helps formulate MAP to us.
Yes, they
so
have.
What they happens have. When they change that number? Do they go back to the state and we?
They don't give the state doesn't request that number until December, after.
Okay.
So.
Okay.
That number is a little bit more firm than
okay.
what they give us in July. They just asked us to verify, which is why I felt a little bit more comfortable using that number now as projection for next year until I'm able to meet with Mr. Smith and the Board of Supervisors.
So the number they're providing, if it was changed or they reduced the evaluation, would be correctly reflected in December versus?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I just want to make sure we're getting the money.
Like I said, it's calculated as a part of our local contributions in our MAP formula, so I want to make sure they get the right numbers too, because it affects us on both ends. Any other questions?
Being all, I'd like to accept Ms. Bird's financial report.
We have a motion and a second. We have a motion and a second to accept the financial report presented by Ms. Bird. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign. We have accepted her report. Next item under, are these items for discussion? The Heartland Bucks?
They are action items with, I'm asking the board to allow us to move forward on the contingent that we can work through contract information with Briggs, because we've been working with Briggs to get some contract terminology corrected and what have you, where he's comfortable. Now, ArborPay, that's not anything that we have to actually physically sign a contract for. but I would like the board's permission to move forward with that program.
Let's do one thing at a time. I think in the future, it might help if these are action items that they not fall into the financial report, that we move them down. Like if they're memorandum of understanding or we're entering a group, that we put them in the regular general items list.
Yes, sir.
So we know that we're taking action on them.
Yes, sir.
Because these don't have, it says action, but it's not telling us what we're, what you're recommending. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Okay, yes, sir. Okay, so what? Yes, sir.
On this, right here, we do have a history of it because the way I understand it, food service is using it now.
Yes.
And
you're on number two. Is this Heartland Bucks?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes,
yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
This one I thought they were, you were
yes,
talking
sir.
About.
Yeah, it is. I'm just trying to make sure I'm on the same page. I'm sorry.
And under the food services, it's the same amount, 3.75% is the percentage that you're charging. And the reason why I asked that question.
Back to the parents, is that what you're asking?
Yes, ma'am. Whatever the
I
cost is.
So.
To, okay.
Yeah.
But we've been using My School Bucks for a little bit longer, and I know that.
Longer or the more people you have on it?
Probably
okay.
Yeah. And I've sent Briggs a copy of that a front page where they have the percentages and all that. And it's pretty much the same as that top page that they're providing us because this would be an extension of the food service agreement.
I wish I got that because my addition and subtraction is very limited. But if I look at the 3.75, we pay $2.50 a month if you're paying for your lunch, it's $2.50 a day. I know because I have to pay $50 a month. But anyway, it sounds big, but it's not as much added on to your bucks right there is what I'm trying to get to. I think everybody was looking at me like, say, wow, it's going to really be. No, it looks like it's about 50 cents a week more that you have to pay.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, for a month, you come out at roughly $2. More a month that you'd have to pay.
Yes, sir.
But which is not bad, but when the parents like me who can't add and subtract see that 3.75%, it just feels big.
Yeah.
But it's not big.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that they're giving us the option of, you know, do we want to roll it into the price? Like if it's for, let's say, we want to use it to where parents can pay for the annual. The convenient fee of the parents being able to pay for the annual online, it would be factored into or give the parents the option of seeing that convenience fee online. So as we set this up, they're giving us options as to how we want to set it up so it would benefit the parent. And the parents can kind of decide if they want that convenience fee or if they just rather see it rolled into the actual overall fee to where, let's say we decide we want to take this mobile and they can take the money, they can take any money at the school site and log it. And it automatically gets deposited into their account from that system, then you can't charge that fee to a parent on site. However, if you roll it into the price of the annual, then it covers everybody, whether they do it on site or whether they do it online. But it still is the convenience of removing cash handling from our employees, as well as it goes straight into our account and it's deposited into our account faster. And we're earning interest faster. That's one of the benefits that they highlighted.
So, Briggs, have you reviewed this?
I have looked at this agreement, and I never saw one before. It's the first time I've seen this agreement, so I'm not sure what contract, if we signed a contract, I never saw it before, this one. You know, there are a few things in this one. Obviously, there's the provision that says it's an out-of-state law that controls it, which we can't enter into on this one. It's got a... I don't think this one had an indemnification provision. And this does have a three-year commitment, three-year term, and the penalties if you don't fulfill the three-year term. I mean, I've got a lot of concerns that I need to address with these people, and I don't know what agreement presently exists. If it was something that was signed,
yeah,
it's pre-me.
What's that?
It was pre-me.
Yeah. Too.
Yeah. Yeah, it was.
So there's really, until you investigate this and
we
figure out what we're currently doing,
I need to see what's been signed.
There's really no action to take right now.
Come through my office. Before, and okay. It may be all I got from the previous agreement was just like a cover sheet kind of thing, just kind of like you're seeing on your computer. I need to take a look at what the contract is, because that.
And I don't think. is that top sheet that has a signature on it was what we were able to find.
But there's a lot more to it than that.
Yes, sir.
The details are
where the devil's
significant.
Right.
A lot of detail. This is a lengthy, complicated agreement.
And one of the reasons why I'm even bringing it to you guys at this point is because if we can work through the T's and C's with Briggs between now and the July board, we can go ahead and implement it instead of waiting to the July board to have you guys approve it. So that's why I was like,
well, I don't know what we're approving, so I don't.
Can I summarize this?
Okay.
This one still needs some work done. The arbiter pay, I don't have anything other than kind of a cover sheet on that. But apparently, it's some kind of umpire agreement where you pay into them. You may know, Mr. Sturgis.
But that's different. That's different from this.
Yeah, I'm going to roll through all of them
quickly
and tell you what all of them are. So I don't know enough about that one to comment. ACL wellness, there are two major issues we got to get resolved up front. Again, the out-of-state law and that was got indemnification provision there. Overall, if y'all were satisfied with it, it's kind of like a wellness plan. If y'all were okay with it, there may be a couple of little tweaks on it we need to work out. And then Spyglass is the one that y'all discussed last month. Now, I don't have any agreement other than what y'all have seen before, what's in here again. That's that deal where if they save you money, they take half the savings. That's just a board decision is what you want to do on that one. So I think we need to work on Heartland. Shaquita and I need to work on Heartland.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you were going to check with them to see on the ACL wellness.
Now,
and then you guys, I don't know about arbiter pay, but y'all just need to decide if you want that Spyglass deal.
The ACL wellness, I did forward you their counselor's information. They are willing to work with us on those two areas, but they felt it would be more advantageous for you and the council, their counselor to talk and work through the terminology that was best, that you were more comfortable with.
All right, so let's stick with one at a time, because
I don't think you can approve that. Heartland and ACL wellness, you can't approve tonight.
I'd like to table those two, please.
We have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second to table Heartland, My School Bucks, and the AC Wellness Solutions. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Okay, so now arbiter pay, we're still okay with?
I don't know anything about arbiter pay.
It's based on
That's
my understanding,
one.
It's not an agreement that we sign. It's something that we would sign up for. It's just like a third-party payment system where 90% of our referees or game officials are already using this through Mississippi High School Activities Association. We're just going through a extra step where we're going on to arbiter pay, printing down the list of referees or umpires or whatever, and signing a physical piece of paper and sending it over to pay. This would give us an opportunity to verify online that they've done the work, and we would actually pay the game officials through that system. Like I said, there was no actual agreement for us to sign. It was just us signing up for the convenience of it, since most of the game officials are already registered through it.
Is there a cost?
It's not a cost to us that I understand.
It's may I say a few things?
Sure.
Please.
Mm-hmm.
If you go up under, it does talk about funding your account, and we would have to send a check, or you know, they'd have to do it electronically. But the cost you're going to ask about, there's a 1099 that somebody's going to have to pay, and then there's a transaction fee that somebody's going to have to pay.
We have the AD.
The 1099 option, if we don't want to do our own 1099s from that system, then we would pay a fee for them to process 1099s and send them out to the game officials.
Mr. Naylor?
What this means for us is instead of a referee getting paid every 2 weeks, they get paid within a day or two time. Cut out the middleman, which is our financial department, because arbiter itself, which is a scheduling system run by MHSA, will pay those officials. Yes, there's a fee, but again, it takes the pressure off of us, because if we miss a payment of an official in some way, form, or fashion, then we got to go back and backtrack, and arbiter takes care of this for us. And not every other school, but 90% of the schools in Mississippi are using arbiter pay already. We're one of the ones that are behind, and I can say that have nothing against Greenville, but Greenville's using arbiter pay to pay their officials so they can get their money in the time of that.
And one thing I will say is with the reduction of paper that we're looking at from this, and the fact that we won't have to cut checks anymore, we would have, that would cut down on the number of checks that we'd be purchasing to cut them. So to me, I guess I don't really see a cost because it offsets. I'm looking at, we don't have to cut checks on a weekly basis, then that cuts down on the number of checks that we're buying to be able to cut AP checks.
Ready for a motion?
Pardon?
You ready for a motion?
Well, I guess you're asking us to, because that's not spelled out here either. What are you asking us to?
I'm asking the board to approve us going forward with the actual arbiter pay program. And if whatever details that needs to be worked out, we can work those out.
Before we promotion, Mr. President, may I ask?
Yes.
May I go back to my original question on funding your account? Mm-hmm. Of course, if I'm reading this correctly, you would have to send in money up front?
Yes, what we would do is we would calculate an average of what we pay officials.
If you're a seasoned official or
right.
You're a rookie.
And then we would use that, cut a PO, and then submit those funds to our arbiter pay account, and we would track it that way and fund the account based on what an average over so many years it would cost us to cut a check to.
So you're going
to
cut a check once, or you're going to cut a check each month?
No, we would fund our account as often as we need. It's like our post office, our postage machine.
So you're going to fund it monthly or yearly?
We'll budget for it annually, but we would fund it quarterly.
Because she has to because of the different football, basketball,
yes.
Baseball, soccer,
yeah.
whatever. So that's the only problem you're going to.
Yes, I said. So we were looking at funding it quarterly because if we do an annual average of what we're paying officials, which we can calculate.
Yeah.
We can divide that into four payments and do a purchase order, an annual purchase order, to go ahead and encumber that money because it's budgeted for, because we're already paying officials, and then just go ahead and fund that account through what we would already be paying officials.
Well, how much are we looking at a year for total, just ballpark?
For our officials, I'm not sure. Do you know?
Give you ballpark.
I'll hold you to it.
Probably about $14,000-$15,000.
Year? Yeah. Annually?
Because different times of the season, baseball, if it's playoffs, they can pay more during playoff time. So
yeah.
It varies depending on the number of games we're playing in postseason.
Okay.
But.
So, but we don't really have the details of what you're asking us to move forward with using the arbiter pay, but there seems to be a lot of bells and whistles or checks. If you're asking us to choose the menu options, are you just asking us to agree with you that you want us to use this system?
No, I want you to approve us moving forward with the program itself.
All right.
Are we ready?
Yes, sir, if you are.
I'd like to make a motion that we accept the arbiter program along with our AD and our finance officer, and I'd like to commend our AD for bringing our sport program into the 21st century. We're behind in the way we do things with that and the way we do them. And that's a vision, and I'm proud to see that. And I'd like to make a motion that we accept that.
Do we have a motion? Is there a second?
There will be, and I'm very wrong for doing this. I was reading here where so much FDIC, but it's going to be put into an unaffiliated FDIC insured trust bank.
Yes.
I think I'm reading this right. They're saying that it will be FDIC insured, the money that you're going to have to pool in.
Mm-hmm.
So you may want to check that just for your records.
Okay.
So with that, let me get back to the original motion. I second the motion. Sturgis second the motion.
We have a motion to accept moving forward with the arbiter pay system and a proper second. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Please move forward. We've tabled Willis. So Spyglass? What's your recommendation? There's no recommendation here. for Spyglass.
We talked about the various elements of Spyglass, and I know you guys had questions and concerns about whether or not this can be done internally. Wade and I talked about it. The cost savings piece, we agree that with us going over to voice over IP, There really isn't much they can do for us on a cost-saving measure, but the cost recovery, we think there will be some benefit in the, them coming in to do this. And Wade and I talked about it. Even if they recover, some money is better than none. So I'm asking the board to...
Okay. I have one question before you ask me. There are multitudes of companies that do the same function. So would we not be best served to, if what part of the services they're offering us to ask people to bid on this? Because if I can get the savings and are there two other companies out here? Have we looked at anybody else? Are we taking the first person on the tree or?
No, I'm not. What I've done is they did contact us and I have pulled the other business manager in my regional group and basically tried to figure out how helpful they've been to them.
So you know someone else that's using them currently?
Yes.
Yes.
There are several other school districts in the state that recommend this.
Okay. All right. And currently, so what are you recommending us use? If we're not going to use the, we're going to use a cost recovery, which is basically where they have been, we have been billed for services and fees on our bill that we should not have been billed for.
Yes, sir.
FCC charges, what all
unused
the.
Unused lines.
Unused line, okay. Not even ours.
They're ours, but we haven't used them.
Fax lines, everything. Yeah, no.
There's
okay.
no usage.
Okay.
Yeah.
So.
What I'm asking the board to is approve for us to go forward with the spyglass process. We would enter into an agreement with them to do the cost recovery. However, I would also like them to do the cost savings to give us options. We don't have to pay them for that unless we choose to move forward with any of those.
Same. So there is an agreement or a contract that still has to be reviewed by the attorney?
Yes, but I didn't want to waste anybody's time. If you guys were not, like I said, you had a lot of concerns and questions about this, and if you were not at a point where you were comfortable with this, I was not going to pursue it, and I'll actually go forward and get the contract and have it forwarded to Briggs if this is something you guys are comfortable with or you approve me moving forward with.
So I guess my question is, are we asking the attorney to review the contract, or are we going to ask you to get a contract, and we're still going to come back and see what the contract is?
It's not for me to answer, but I think you need to decide if you want to go
I don't
forward
think it,
and do you want to do, if you want to go forward, do you want to do cost savings or cost recovery? If I understand what Ms. Burke is presenting to you, but
that's why.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Superintendent?
I think free money is good money, and the way that it's set up is we've squandered funds that we should have been paying attention to that we have not. We got a company at the table wanting to recover those funds for us. It's my recommendation we move forward.
Is there a motion?
I'd like to make a motion that we adhere to our superintendent and the finance office on our recovery and a motion.
Is there a second?
Cost recovery, that's what we need to be clear on. But
yeah,
if I want
just the cost
recovery.
Recovery.
Okay.
Okay. Is there a second?
All right.
Seeing as no second. Give me your nut.
Is that it?
All right. No second. Motion dies.
And we got one more.
What's? I don't have an attachment.
Okay, I think we're at six.
How far is
six? It's Smith Shellnut.
Yeah, but I don't have an attachment on the board document.
Okay, it's actually information only, and I put a sheet in front of you guys.
Can we make sure that gets put on board docs? Because that's how we need to be operating in the future.
Yes, sir.
Ahead of time, too, please.
I apologize, but I knew that you guys had questions about investment, and I wanted to see if Mr. Allen's schedule would be free to kind of give you guys some general information on investing as a whole. I'm not asking the board to take any action. I just wanted to get some general information to you and have any questions that you have to be answered. So if and when you do decide you want to move forward with investing, then that will be one of the hurdles we've already crossed. And I will ask Alan to come and talk to you guys about, like I said, some general information on investments. Alan.
Thanks, Keita. I'm Alan Leach. I'm representing Smith, Shelton & Wilson. We're an SEC registered investment advisor in Madison. I've been asked by Shakita to come over and discuss the generalities and some broad pictures of the investing process for 16 section funds in particular, but it can include other funds that might be investable for the district. Our firm does that, so we do have some background. As you've heard discussed a couple times today, there has been reduced funding and questions about future funding for school districts, not only in Mississippi, but across the country. We have tried to help address this problem in Mississippi and are working with a number of school districts to do that. The history for 16 section type money precedes the Constitution of the United States of America. The United States Congress of the Confederation in 1785 first put aside land, 16 section land, to be given to the schools for their benefit in perpetuity and under the trusteeship of the state to provide income or benefits for the school districts. Mississippi has been smart enough to continue that process. Not all other states do that. In fact, I think at this point in time, probably only one, perhaps two, and none in the Deep South are doing that. So in fact, the access to 16 section funds and that's used, and their use for the benefit of the school district is something that is quite special and to be cared for. The reason we got into this business is because we've got other clients that serve on school boards, and what they were seeing was that the banks were no longer interested in paying a reasonable return on depository accounts. Let me go ahead and say right now, we manage about 30 community bank portfolios across five states as well. We understand their position. When you put money in a bank, they have to secure that with securities. So their profitability is immediately cut on that. Plus, they don't have loan demand, and the rates are so compressed right now, they cannot make money on public funds. Most of the banks that are in the country right now are trying to run off public monies because they simply cannot perform with them to the satisfaction of their stockholders. And at the end of the day, that's who they want to please, as they should. Specifically addressing Mississippi, if you take a look at the just short sheets that I gave out, there are three basic documents that we believe control what this board and other boards in the state can do. Section of Mississippi Code Section 293.113 appears to anticipate that boards will actively invest the money. It says it shall be the duty of the Board of Education to keep the principal fund invested. Now, in fact, those investments that become listed a little later on also include depository accounts. So it's not that you've not been doing your duty, it's just that there are other things that may be done. It goes on to talk about the things that you can do, and it basically says that you can do any type of investment in which any other political subdivision of the state of Mississippi may invest, except that you may invest 100% of your money. The state's money, there has to be reserves held and so forth. You're not so restricted. In clarifying that, the wording there being clarified being the any other political subdivision, Attorney General's opinion 2008-674 said, from the authorities cited above, it appears that a school district is authorized to invest funds not currently needed in investments in which any political subdivision is authorized to make. Since the Mississippi Housing Corporation is considered a public subdivision and is authorized to invest in certain obligations of insurance firms and other corporations, a school district may also invest in other corporations and other such obligations. So we go to the Mississippi Home Corp sections, which is 4333717. Let me say that we are very familiar with that. We manage money for the Mississippi Home Corporation as well. You are entitled to invest in, or you are allowed to invest in, all the things that we've got listed there. Basically, it falls, though, into four categories that are useful for you. Obligations of the United States government, obligations of the agencies of the government, obligations of any municipality or the state of Mississippi, any municipality in the state or the state of Mississippi itself, not other states. You could not buy a an obligation from a Louisiana municipality, for example. Or, and the final thing that's in here, and that's what the AG's opinion was addressing, is corporate bonds, A-rated or better. Okay. We take those, and what we do with that then is to use that authority to construct an appropriate portfolio for school districts to do two things: maximize income and protect principal. 16th section fund is held in trust by this district, and it should not be put at risk. That is why the state was very specific in what you can use and why all the things that you can use are of very high quality. The things then that we would need to do to build a portfolio are listed in the last paragraph there. A, strict compliance with state law. Secondly, diversification among types of issuers to mitigate any portfolio concentrations. In other words, we would not just have all governments or all corporates, we would have a mixture of all of those. Diversification among issuers within the types. We would not buy just one government agency, we would have several. We would have several different municipalities in the state itself. The maturities of those securities would be distributed along a maturity curve that is appropriate for a school district, typically, in our experience, with an average weighted life of 3 to 7 years. That's long enough to get you some increased income and yet short enough to not put you at great danger in terms of interest rate fluctuations. And also, you need to regularly review and assess the portfolio to make sure it is accomplishing the goals that were set out for it to accomplish in the beginning. It is different than putting the money in the bank in that a portfolio doesn't have a day it matures and that you can come clean with it and get out. It will be a series of maturities. However, the way we approach that is that when we buy a security for a school district, it is our intention always to hold that security until the day it matures. One reason we do that is to mitigate risk. One of the other piece of paper you've got, and we call it our smiley chart because it looks like a mouse. People always, and boards rightly so, are worried about market risk. Well, the items that we buy have very little credit risk, if any, attached to them. So that is avoided and minimized at every step. Secondly, you do have market risk. If interest rates go up, the value of your portfolio will go down. It's mathematic. Nothing else could possibly happen. But if you hold that security to the day it matures, you will always get your money back, and that's what this illustrates. The top line illustrates if rates go down by 2% on a five-year security, that the value of it would go up, but then would come right back down at maturity to the face value. Likewise, if rates go up by 2%, the market value will drop temporarily, but then will achieve, again, its face value at maturity. Plus, you will have earned the interest that will have been paid monthly, quarterly, or semi-annual, depending upon which security it is. So this is a very low-risk way of running a portfolio. We always intend to hold a maturity. We have sold before for different districts, but usually under guidance to sell something for a unique need or if we found a better alternative to move into and could, in fact, profit from the sale for the district. That is kind of the basics of what's going on out there. We manage 15 other districts at this point in time. If you look at the larger districts in the state, if they're not with us, they certainly are familiar with us and have talked to us. We are managing about $100 million at this point for school districts. Not all of which is 16th section, but a great deal of it is.
Yeah, and the main, and like I said, the main purpose of Mr. Leach being here is for you guys to ask him whatever questions or address any concerns that you may have. So when we do start visiting this down the line, that will be one of the hurdles that we've already crossed.
I'd love to answer any questions you might have. I'll try to.
Mr. Leach, I'm going to try to ask you an intelligent question.
I'll try to give an intelligent answer.
you mentioned that your items have little risk.
Yes.
When you consider that, you consider CDs, which has little risk, but pays nothing.
Right.
You're going to have bonds, you're going to have your treasury bills, you know, your municipalities, if we don't pay our debts, then our municipalities are gone. say all of that to say this, is that it is, the money that you are investing is tied to the stock market.
Not the stock market at all. You are not allowed to invest in any stocks, any equities whatsoever. It'll all be bonds, fixed income.
Okay.
So there would not be, to the extent you can own a company's paper, it would be a bond. Typically, commercial paper are very short corporate bonds. We tend to keep them with an end maturity no more than 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
And it has to be A-rated or better, which we're talking General Electric, we're talking Cornell, we're talking Yale, we're talking people of that sort, Bank of America, people that you know that are very big and very strong and are, I would never say there's no risk. There's risk in everything. But the risk is minimal. I will also tell you this, in terms of the municipalities you mentioned, we don't just buy them when they come out. We do a background credit workup on every security that's out there that we buy that's a municipality. We don't do it on government bonds. But all the municipal bonds that we buy for any client, we do a complete financial workup to make sure that they are in good condition, that somebody that we can recommend.
Could we lose out on the face value? The principle that we put in?
That is our whole effort, is to make sure that you do not do that.
But
that
is possible.
It is certainly possible. Nothing is impossible. There was a Ed Pool being run several years back, and they owned some Lehman Brothers. The Lehman Brothers went bankrupt. It is possible. It is highly unlikely, but I would never tell you it's not possible.
Yes, sir. Your cost that's going to cost us to pay you, is it based on the amount that we would give to you, or
yes.
Do you have a flat fee?
No, it's based on what you put with us. We have a sliding scale. It begins at 0.25% a year, and that's the rate up to 4.8 million. Between 4.8 and 9.6 million, it declines to 1/8% per year you're paying us. Now, let me tell you what that would do for you. Rates right now, we're able to get somewhere between 1.5% and 2% right now, generally speaking, in these portfolios. If in the next 2 or 3 years, rates do go up and that 2% becomes 4%, you get all of that increase. We'll still be getting paid on the amount we manage, not what the interest rate is. So we'd still be getting our 1/4 to 1/8. You'd get all the increase in the interest rate in the general market paper.
Only thing, I'm in a quagmire because Ms. Yellen has talked about rates probably won't go up, and so we're going to be probably around that, which is 1.5 or 2% is great, according to 0.25 or 0.10 that you get at the banks right now, which is pretty good. And I'm not trying to dominate this. If somebody else wants to say something. On Mr. Lee, if it's locked in for 3 years, and we can talk later. I don't want to sit up here and dominate this. But that's one of the few things that I know something about. Very little, but I know something about. The 3 years, if we need the money, then we would have to pay a fee to get that money released.
No, sir. You're not, it isn't a 3-year commitment. It is your portfolio. We run it for you. You own those securities item by item. So if you needed money, you would instruct us to sell some securities into the market, getting the best that we can get to fund whatever needs you have. That's why Ms. Burke and I would have to work very closely to make sure we were fully aware of any anticipated needs that might be coming up. We have gone through that. We work for Lamar County. They built a brand new school in Oak Grove. They told us they were going to fund it out of 16th section money, so we built the portfolio to have money available every time they needed it. And they never had a day when they didn't have enough money to fund all their costs. We've had at least one other have an emergency call, and we were able to sell off securities at a profit, and we're not ever put in that position. We were lucky in that case, I'll just tell you. They gave us a little time to work it, and we were able to get out. But we will do all we can. We are paid a fee. We're not selling you the securities. We're out buying them for you and building this portfolio for you. We are a hired gun. You employ us to do your work for you on this, and we will do it the way you want it done, to the best of our ability. We do have a fiduciary responsibility. We're like a trust department. We are obligated to put your needs and desires first in every case. That's one reason we are paid a flat fee. We have no possible gain, depending on what we buy ourselves. We have no gain for that. We just do that at the same fee. And the bigger you get, the smaller your fee gets.
Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
Next on our agenda is our consent agenda, consisting of sections F, G, H, I, and J. We have several items to pull currently, which I'll read, and then we'll see if there are any other items to pull. Currently, we're pulling for discussion F5, F7, F10, F11, G5, and J2. Are there any other items to pull for discussion? Seeing none, do we have a motion to accept the consent agenda with the exclusions of F5, 7, 10, 11, G5, and J2?
Sturgis like to make that motion with the exception of the ones that you asked to be pulled.
Okay. We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion, a proper second, to approve the consent agenda with the exclusions of F5, 7, 10, 11, G5, and J2. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Uh-huh.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign. Presented consent agenda has been approved. Next, first item for discussion would be items F5, which is school instruction management plan.
Yes, sir. All I need to ask, Mr. President, is before I make a complete idiot out of myself, were we given this a month ahead of time? Because I couldn't read it in the 4 days.
Oh, yeah, no, you're fine. That can be, we can make that where you do that. That is correct. You can do that.
Would you like to motion table it to the next meeting?
Uh-huh. Absolutely.
Okay. Is that your motion?
Yeah. I'd like to make a motion that we table F5 until the next meeting, please.
Is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion, a proper second, to table the school instructional management plan for next meeting for review. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign. Item tabled. Next item is America Reads, F7.
Mr. President, two things on this one. I was reading that, are we paying, or is everything going through the grant on this America Reads? Because the reason why I say that, Mr. Superintendent, and if you turn to the second page too,
mm-hmm.
It talks about required cash match, and then the school board meeting date is wrong also, if we approve this.
That's correct.
So my question is it appears that we are waiting to see if they're going to get a grant, but if they get it, will we have to match the money that they get for the grant?
Yes, sir. Our cost is $5,600.
Okay.
That's the, and basically a lot of the schools that are using this, they're in their federal plans and are utilizing them as teacher assistants, which is a good bit cheaper per that personnel slot than if we provide. And I changed June 21, 2016, the date. Good catch.
Yes, sir. With that, I'd like to make a motion with the necessary changes with the school board meeting date that we accept the America Reads program.
Is there a second?
Second.
Have you reviewed?
On page one of the attachment.
Gotcha.
All right, we have a motion and proper second to approve F7 for America Reads with the correction of the school board meeting date. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign. America Reads partnership is approved. Next item for discussion is F10, the MHS dental memorandum of understanding.
Yes. I see, Mr. Hobson has reviewed the MOU, which is perfect. I just have, on page two, if you turn to page two in this package right here, I think it talks about the facilities. Do we have the facilities to have the chair, the access to water? I know we have access to water, the sink and commode facilities. So do we, and they need stuff to sterilize. So are we equipped?
They actually handle.
I think it's just saying we include the room for those things.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, we just provide the room so they can have those items.
Oh, they'll take care of that part.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. Is it going to be just one location, or is it going to be?
The way they've done it in the past is they work out with the principal so it doesn't adversely affect the instructional time, and they've been flexible. The places that we've done it have seen good benefit, and they come in and work with the principals for those times.
So it's different schools?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Before you make a motion, Mr. Sturgis, do you have any other questions?
No, sir.
Look at the 1, 2, 3, 4th paragraph on the first page. I did, and Shannon's been so kind to listen to me bellyache about a few things, but that paragraph says that they have provided the superintendent a list of local dental offices. Last year when we entered the agreement, I remember the part of what y'all approved was that they would provide a list, because I remember Mr. Sturgis made the motion that he wanted to know which local dentists would be available to provide services. And they say in here they provided it. I don't know if they provided that for sure. Have you gotten a list, Mr.
This year, no, but I can, we can get another one.
All right. Well, let's, if your motion is to approve it contingent upon them providing that list of dental offices, that would be the best thing to do.
I'd like to make a motion that we accept F10 contingent upon that we get the list of all local dentist offices that were contacted.
Is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a proper second to approve F10 with the stipulation that we are provided, as mentioned in the contract, the list of local dentist offices. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign. Item has been approved. Next item is our F11 is our student handbooks.
Were we given this?
Mr. Campbell?
Yes.
We were given this to read. I'm just asking.
In the board packet or the month before?
Yeah, I'm just asking.
It's in the board packet.
To read a long time ago, then I'll just go and approve it because I haven't read it.
You received it in the board packet?
Oh, this time?
Yes,
I didn't have enough time to read it. I didn't read it because we just got it on
Is there
Friday.
Anything, if I guess what Mr. Sturgis is asking is if he gives, is there anything that we need to approve this today so that you can move forward with printing them, or is that going to cause a problem if we take his time to read through it, or can someone summarize any major changes, or?
If we have to wait until the next board meeting, we won't have them ready for students, because that will be about 10 days to get them printed. I can tell you that the only changes made to that were some additions in the discipline where we had some things that we needed to add that weren't covered.
One of the things, for example, we took out, there was a whole hair color issue and things that had been set up in the past. So, like you can't wear bow ties to graduation, those kinds of things.
I saw something about sagging pants and all that. Okay, would you do this for me, Mr. Deputy Superintendent? One good thing we've had in the past, when they did change it, they would put it in red or
red line strike
pink
out.
Or blue or something, so it could catch my eye on the difference. If you don't mind. So I will heed to you that you're giving me proper information and make this motion. And if not, you'll hear from me at the next.
Can I make one other point is that we're about to approve, and I assume we haven't approved it, even though it says consent, we didn't include section L as part of our consent when we made the motion, so it technically hasn't been approved. But we have an item for approving of the acceptable use policy for the computers, that be added to the handbook before it's printed.
Correct. We couldn't add it before y'all
approve it. So if you want to make a motion, I would like to request that we add the section that if L1 is approved,
okay.
Please make sure it is added in the policy.
All
So we have it there. Any further questions on this? Do we have a motion?
I'd like to make a motion that we approve the student handbook with the understanding that if the technology policy is approved, we include it in the student handbook.
Is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion, a proper second, to approve the student handbooks with stipulation of the technology use policy. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign. F10 has been approved. Next item for discussion is G5, approval additional summer duties.
I guess I have this. Is the amount that's on here, is that for the teacher? Is it for the students? How many students do we have up there? Will it, some of the students leave? When does it start? When will it end? I see it's a 6 week period, but program. But I guess I asked all that to see how many. Does it include material, books? Is that the total cost of everything, or is that just at the detention center?
This came from the requirement that JDC is required that all those be 12-month programs, and we're adjusting to what NDE findings were on that. Ms. Burke, you can attest to whether these expenditures are salary only.
The $4,000 is just her summer pay. It is less than her daily rate during this school year, but it is her summer pay.
So it doesn't include anything with the kids, or you know how many kids we have up there?
No, I
don't. It fluctuates. Last time I was in there, it seemed like there was only about six or eight, but then again, that can change every day.
And we do get reimbursements from MDE for JDC. And the things that MDE does not reimburse us for, we are allowed to prorate and allocate it out evenly to the other districts that we serve.
Which is South Delta and Claiborne County. So they could have 22 kids show up tomorrow from Claiborne County that we would serve because that's how we're set up with our economic
system. Right. Okay, so it's not just our kids.
That's correct.
Correct. Okay, got you covered. Thank you. I'd like to approve G5, please.
We have a motion to approve G5. Is there a second?
Is it started already?
Yes, sir, but we have not done our first payroll, yes, and I could not physically pay her until you guys had
it. And it ends 6 weeks from June 1 to
yes.
6 weeks later?
Yes.
Gotcha, go. Okay, yes. I'd like to make a motion that we accept G5, please.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion and proper second to approve additional summer duties. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign. G5 has been approved. Next item for discussion is J2, approval of security bids.
This one was kind of tricky. We only had two bidders to submit bids for it. We went through the bid process, and I know there's been some concern throughout the district about the service that we're getting with our current vendor. And since they were the only one that actually qualified, the other bidder did not meet all the specs, so they got disqualified. So I wanted to give the board the option to either accept them as the one and only winning bid, or allow me the option of rejecting all bids and start the process over and extend a wider reach for see if we get more input.
Currently, when you advertised this, it was advertised where?
My understanding is that they advertised it in Vicksburg Post.
And with wider net, she means Jackson area, metro.
Port Gibson. Yes, I figure anywhere within a 30-mile radius would get them to our location in a timely manner. So that's only based on the feedback that I've gotten across the district from our employees. I wanted to give you guys, the board, the opportunity to say, yes, we want to continue and move forward or reject all bids and start over.
What's the current amount for the current year? I see what their bid, each vendor's bidding for the next year. What's a current yearly expenditures?
I can't give you specific numbers, but I will tell you that their bid went up. The hourly rate went up by 25 cents on the individual schools, and then the special projects went up about 75 cents per hour.
It appears, Ms. Burks, that you've done your due diligence, at least, again, putting it out there for somebody to try to do the service.
Yes, sir.
And one something I'm really glad to see, and then I'll get off my horse, I promise, is the call-out alarms. I'm glad to see that's been removed.
Yes, sir.
We have our great SROs who can go out and take care of that.
Yes, and we also removed the night patrol, too, because they were not performing those services. So Dwayne and I worked together on those specs to make sure if they were not performing those services, we pulled them out the bid.
So when your request RFP that went out for these items that weren't provided,
yes,
they were clearly spelled out in that RFP.
Yes, sir.
That you need to quote on per hourly rate for special functions.
Yes, sir.
And you must provide required insurance certification.
Yes, sir.
They can't read. Probably don't need to be doing our security.
Go
ahead. Yes,
sir. I'd like to make a motion that we do accept the security bid that's been presented to us with all of the qualifications that was asked for, which would be Baker Security for a year, right?
Yes, sir.
We have a motion to accept the lowest bid presented, qualifying bid presented. Is there a second?
Question.
Yes, sir.
I'm curious to see the widening of the bid. I mean, if this was just in the Vicksburg Evening Post, not in the Clarion Ledger, not in.
And that was one of the. That was one of the things that we followed the process that, as far as advertisement that we've used in the past, and looking at what came in, I said this is why we're getting what we're getting because of where we are advertising. And if next time we bid it, or if you guys decide you want us to rebid this, then we would do a wider stretch and actually cater to or advertise in more papers, especially anywhere within a 30-mile radius.
So is the current the second one that didn't qualify, are they local?
Yes.
So we have a motion to accept Baker Security, the lowest quoted bid, but we don't have a second. Is there, because we've also heard that you might want to consider going out. Is there a second or?
Before I get to something, are we getting on the same page with some of the things that we want in our security system?
I think they've provided the services. We have had some issues. We've had some personnel issues, which they've addressed after we had to deal with them with some of the people that they hired. Dwayne directly supervises all that. So I don't assume that they haven't been where we've asked them to be, and they've done the scope of the service.
Yeah. I'm sorry. One thing that I would like to make sure we all in complete agreement with is, if you guys decide you want me to put it back out for rebid, then that would mean re-advertising, and then it would be, I would put an ad in each one of those papers wherever we decide to bid. So that would be additional cost. That's why I'm leaving it up to you guys how you want to proceed.
Well, we have a motion to approve Baker Security, and we have a second. All those in favor of approving the only qualifying and lowest bid, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign. We've approved Baker Security's.
Okay, and I'll work with them to get a 1-year agreement and get with Briggs to get it approved. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Next. K, section K.
K1, you have no attachment. We had the agreement that I had sent Briggs, and we were working through some of those. That's the guy that spoke to us about the opportunity for some of our expelled students to have. We've since received an email from the state superintendent and Gene Massey, and they've invited three districts to come this Thursday to review that process. So hopefully there'll be some clarification on state law and those other wiggles that we were concerned about. So I'll be giving you more information on that as the reason it's blank. I started to pull it, but I figured I could go ahead and talk about it since it was there.
Superintendent, I'll remind me to bring up one thing on that green graduation lines before you go to the meeting. A question for you to ask.
Okay.
So there's nothing, no action right now, just
no action, just information.
All right.
Would like for you to approve the strategic plan. We have vetted it through multiple people, and this would be our plan that we would develop, a very pretty one, and then submit that to MDE for a strategic plan. That is K2.
And this is a new requirement for, or is this a?
Well, this is an old requirement.
Old requirement.
We got one. That's correct. We located one, and I think it was 86.
And we're supposed to have one on file or submit it. How often is it supposed to be updated?
Annually.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I move we accept the superintendent's recommendation.
We have a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendation of the presented strategic plan. Is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the strategic plan. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Aye. Those opposed, same sign. Item is approved. Item three, is this?
Briggs.
Have you reviewed item three? Can we discuss that?
Hang on one second. Where are we?
This is the light pole.
Yeah, that there's really the analysis. It's not really a legal analysis. It's the question, and I think Ms. Burks outlined it here. It is whether the savings will be sufficient to overcome the additional upfront expenses. Those poles were owned by Entergy. You're going to have to purchase the poles, I guess, and the lights. You have to purchase those. But then the question is if a long-term savings is going to be greater than what you're going to pay out upfront. So it's a financial analysis, not a legal issue.
Yeah, if we buy it, we get a energy rebate of the $50,000. And we work with the Johnson Controls because ultimately the way it currently sits is we're renting them and they're wired into our building. So we're paying for the energy and we're paying for the pole. And, you know, if we go through the process of energy keeping all that, that's our bottom line cost on the right. If we buy it, that's our cost on the left.
Right. And we don't get to utilize the rebate option if we don't go forward, we don't buy them. And they will have to pull those two sites, those sets of lights out of the Johnson Control project. And I think JD said it was about $9,000-$10,000 that we would actually leave on the table if we don't include those.
So recommendation is to buy.
Yes.
That's what I want to hear.
Recommendation is to buy.
Which would be $67,000.
Yes, sir.
I have a question.
Sure.
Any attempt to talk with Cooper Lighting, which is now called Eaton, to donate to the schools? They have done that in the past.
I'm not sure about that. I know they're one of the vendors that we're utilizing. It is the vendor that's supplying the lights through Johnson Controls.
Those are Cooper lights that we have purchased with that.
Zero.
You need a motion?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'd like to make a motion that we purchase the poles that are at Dana Road and Sherman Avenue location.
Is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion and proper second to accept the superintendent's recommendation of purchasing the poles at Sherman and Dana and including them in our energy saving plan. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Motion carried. All right. Attention.
L1.
Pardon?
L1.
Oh, we're not doing 4. Huh?
Oh, I'm sorry.
I got it.
I'm sorry. I don't have the revised one. I apologize. Yeah.
Attendance software and service agreement.
Yes. This can be reviewed. Y'all can look at this guy. Attention to attendance is a software. What we found is we have a huge chronic absenteeism problem. And it's what chronic absenteeism is not just a kid that's absent. It's this kid is absent a bunch. So as we start looking at that, there's reporting processes that this particular service allows us, and it operates like an off-site secretary, sets up conferences, and it sends specific emails at specific times, and letters to the House, sets up the opportunity. They've shown where they've had a 7 to 10% reduction in chronic absenteeism in the companies that they're working with. I have negotiated a incredibly reduced price for that, but I don't like for y'all to make those decisions the first time you see it, so it's there, and at the following board meeting, if y'all would just kind of give me any questions, and I always clarify any kind of legal signings with Briggs prior to bringing it back to you, so at the next board meeting, you'll...
So he hadn't reviewed this contract yet?
That's correct.
Okay. But you're not asking us to make a decision?
Not tonight.
Okay.
Do we have a truancy officer?
We do.
Okay, so what is his or her job?
His or her job is to notify the court after we notify them, and they decide, they do home visits and...
So is this a truancy officer?
No, this is not a truancy officer. This is a automated mailing system. Basically, it would be if I hired a secretary or a person to do this for every building in our district, and then pay the postage, and then set the meetings up. This is a system that does all of that.
It would help notify a parent in advance of it getting to the truancy.
Right, and let me give you an example. I had a parent that called me, and we notified the truancy officer by state law within 48 hours of that absence. The truancy officer then contacted the parent and said, your kid was out. Well, then the parent turned around and said, my kid wasn't out. So after we got through walking through, those letters would help us identify if there's any clerical issues or if the kid was skipping or whatever it is before a truancy officer was involved. So it's in addition to that. But also we have kids that will come in who are at the juvenile detention center, which may fall through the cracks. And we're trying to put avenues in place where we have our children here, because not only does it impact us financially, but every time a kid's not sitting in a chair, they can't learn.
Do we pay the truancy officer?
It's reimbursed through the state. But yes, they're on our payroll. They're our employee, right?
No.
Truancy officer. Okay. Do we just provide space for them?
I think we just provide space
okay.
for them. Because that was, I happened to be one of those parents who got the...
Oh, really?
Yeah, just so you know. And my child was there. But there's no, it's very frustrating to get a note like that to say your kid wasn't here, and then you're playing round robin to get it resolved. And the school, after 20, you know, by the time you get the letter, the school's got better things to do than to track down this problem. If you can solve it up front when it happened, there's more facts available. You can get the records more accurate.
And the guy is actually in California, and he's agreed to come to the board. I told him to hold off, don't come tonight. I wanted y'all to get the opportunity to look at it. If you so desire, I can tell him to be at the next board meeting for any questions.
I'm looking for cost here.
It's about $23,000. Isn't that right? Or is that?
No.
It's in there.
Okay.
Oh.
There it is.
No, 37.
37,000.
They handle all the postage, all the letters, all the envelopes, all the printing. There's a software that notifies, and then they have a dashboard that disaggregates all the data so that you can identify the particular kids. Because what it does is it sets up counseling sessions with those children to talk about the importance of school. And I know deer hunting is important, and I know family vacations are important, but if those can be planned outside the school, that's kind of what we begin a conversation about.
So I guess my question would be to ask, just seeing this right off the top of my head, is they're charging us for the letters. And is that the cost of sending the letters? To me, if I only had to send out 10 letters, and it's cost me $16,700 for 10 letters.
There was a per.
Or is it per letter? Because
There was a per letter cost on average. Yeah. But they looked at our data to put those trends by our current absenteeism rate.
Okay. I guess I'm a little hesitant, and the reason I haven't read it, so I'll tell you that. But when my son wasn't in school. I won't say he was. He's graduated, thank goodness, so I can talk about it now. I would get a call that night.
Correct. We do that.
So why do we need, and I guess that's my question, We have a truancy officer, they call us at night, and then we want to pay $37,000 to send out letters.
And well, schedule conferences and set up the counseling services through that. And the reason is because we're one of the worst chronic absenteeism districts in the state, and we're trying to find ways to, and those are choices that some are made, you know, by parents and some are made by kids, but we're just trying to put things in place that hold us accountable to make sure that we've, that the kids are here.
And I agree with you, Jim. I will say this, though, for my, my experience was I didn't get a call because I may not have been at home when the call out one happened. So my kid wasn't there, or they thought he wasn't there, and the call went out, no one answered the phone, or he answered the phone. And then, you know, everyone's the wiser, right? You know, no one knows about it. So I mean,
and sometimes those absences happen in concurrent months that are prior to, and once those have already been updated through MCIS, it's difficult to go back and capture that presence. Yeah. But that's the reason, Mr. Sturgis. I'm trying to find any way I can to increase the attendance of our students.
But you're not asking us to act. You're just this.
No. This information only at this point.
Okay. Yes, sir. So board, just please review that. Next item would be our item K5.
And I would ask.
Salary schedule for child nutrition.
One of the questions that was asked is we brought at the last board meeting, there were some salaries that were brought through child nutrition, and Mr. Joe brought to the point that he didn't see why we had certain schedules for the cafeteria staff and we have a different schedule for the district. And Laura at that point went out and met with Ms. Burke to try to align those two. So if you have any questions specifically, she's available to ask questions.
So are you asking us to take action to approve this, or is this information?
That's information. The July 1 budget begins, so it would need to be in effect as soon as possible to affect those salaries if it changed.
I see you say 1 year, 2 years. So this is based on the number of years.
Years of experience.
Yes, sir.
Okay. It moved them from a step, which they're currently on, to a year of experience like everybody else across the district.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Do we know what the changing this is going to cost us? Is it negligible? Is it?
$120,000 to the federal nutrition budget. They operate under, even though it's federal, it's their own entity outside the general fund. So as far as our impact from the general fund side, it does not affect us.
So they'll pay them anything we want? Let's give them all a raise. Is that what you're saying? Someone's got to pay it.
Only question I'll ask, it's a two-part question. When do we have a pay scale for teachers? And is it 1 through 30 years?
It's 1 through 35.
Or 45.
35.
Once I'm teacher 36, I won't get a raise again. Is that what you're telling me?
No.
So it's just that.
Yes.
So that's what you're doing with this, that once they meet?
Actually, after 30 years, I'm continuing the 2% increase that's in there. If you would like me to stipulate that on the bottom of the scale, I'll be more than glad to.
Okay.
But I do not put a cutoff.
Okay. Would you repeat that? I didn't hear.
I have not put a stipulation on STAR stipulating that after the 30-year mark, you would continue to get the 2% raise, which is a factor that's in that.
Yes, ma'am.
But I was going to continue on past 30 years. I only have two staff members that have hit the 30-year mark. One is Mr. Vernon, and then one is, I have a lady that's
I know it's rare to stay anywhere that long this day and time.
Yes, sir.
Well, I sure hope to get to stay here.
Yeah, I would think we
just say.
I would think, because the way this is presented is the way it reads, just from face value, is that basically after 30 years it stops.
Correct.
But that's not your intent. Your intent is basically you have demonstrated through this scale that you're giving a 2% raise.
So would you
or that
be kind enough to add that in here?
I'll be more than
because
glad.
Because I will forget it at the next meeting and ask you the same question.
So you're not needing, is this going to cause you a problem, Ms. Burke, if we don't approve this today?
No.
Okay. For next year's, because We haven't, okay. All right, so that is really for just consideration then, if you're not asking us to approve it today. All right, next item on the agenda is our board policy proposed consent agenda for the technology acceptable use policy, IBJ, and but both of those are being in the handbook. We're not having a separate handbook, am I correct? These are just a policy that is going to be added to the student handbook. Is that right?
Couldn't add it until y'all approve it.
All right. Do we have any questions related to the acceptable use policy? This is a policy we presented last month and sat for 30 days, and we needed to have in place to for our students to have policies for they lose a laptop or proper use of a laptop, those kind of things, or the devices that we're providing in the starting of the next school year. Any questions? Do we have a motion to accept the policy?
I can make a motion that we accept our policy on our IGB handbook.
We have a motion and a proper second to approve the technology use policy IJB. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign.
Mr. President.
Yes, sir.
Ask a question. Oh,
may
I?
Yes, sir.
On our Chromebooks, how would they be identified by each student? Will the name be?
Each device will have its own asset tag as anything else that's property wise, and that asset tag number will be associated with each student in the system.
Yep.
So we will know who's got what device.
And it will be, if I check out a device, if I check out a temporary device, I won't be able to leave the building with that, or will be able to leave the building with that?
Will not be able to leave the building with a temporary device.
Yeah. So if I leave my device at home or?
The temporary devices are only meant to be used by students whose parents will not pay the technology fee or do not want the students bring a device home. They will come to the library each morning, check the device out, and return it at the end of the school day.
If the student misplaces it, does he pay for it?
After 3 days, yes, sir. After an affidavit has been filed that has been lost or stolen, yes, they pay to replace it.
And the current cost is 150?
About 157 for the device itself.
Which, honestly, for a brand new textbook, that's about the cost of a brand new textbook. Brand new textbook.
We've been able to negotiate the price down.
Yeah, he's about as good a negotiator as I am.
All right, any further, did that satisfy your question?
Yes.
Okay. Next on the agenda is our executive session items, so I would entertain a motion to go into closed session to determine the agenda for executive session.
Mr. Chairman, I move we go into closed session to set the agenda for our executive session.
Second. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Ladies and gentlemen, we are now in closed session. Thank you very much.